I'm Kevin Hogan, president of Rock Island Auction Company, and I'm here today with my friend, Richard Ellis. I have to tell you, from the initial prospect of being able to acquire and market the Robert Bretherton Collection, Richard and I have talked about doing this video. This is 6 months in the making. We have dreamed of it, and the day has arrived. Just to speak about the collection and what it means to come to the market, I've described the Bretherton Collection as a market-defining collection, because whether you're interested in 17th century high-art wheellocks or you're interested in German semi-automatic pistols, the collection is important to you. It's important to your collection because there's something for you. There's something you don't have. Richard had talked about the collection for many years, and when we walked in there, it was the aha, jaw-dropping moment where essentially you have walked into King Tut's tomb. There is nothing on this table that is common. It is all in condition. There is no museum selection that you will see in the world that has the depth, that has the significance, that has the scope, that's displayed here on the tables, but also contained within the collection. So Richard, again, I know we've been kind of chomping at the bit. This is our opportunity. If you're at home, I would say strap on your seatbelts, because we're going to talk about some of this stuff. We're going to get into some of the stuff that, one, you've only read about in books, and two, you didn't know existed.
Well, first of all, Bob Bretherton was a close friend of mine, and I considered him a mentor, of all things. He was a walking encyclopedia of any kind of weapon, starting from the 16th century Chinese hand cannons on up to the automatic pistols. He's best known for the automatic pistols because at the time that they were available, which was in the early 1960s, which we even have photos of him before I was born at a gun show collecting these sort of weapons. What we have here is this one section of his collection, but mind you, this is just a beginning of his collection. What we've done is to try to put out the different early automatic pistols, and I guess I could start if you would like.
Well, just real quick, too, and just talking to the marketplace, I mean, I am a novice when it comes to semi-automatic pistols, but I know the history of the collectors, I know the history of collections. In terms of where this collection falls in the pantheon of, one, great collectors, and two, semi-automatic pistol collectors, where does the Bretherton Collection rank?
At the top. It truly... There's other collections that were assembled at the same time. There was Sidney Aberman, for example. He was a contemporary of Bob Bretherton. And he put together a collection which included the 45 Luger and such that yours truly handled at one time. But Bob Bretherton had everything that he had with the exception of a few things that only one person could have. And the difference with Bob Bretherton's collection is he put it in quality, quantity. You know, he would have variations within pistols. Say, for example, over here, in their lifetime, people have never seen this many prototype Walthers. Well, those are all the same model. Do they look alike? No. You know, that is an MP, that is an MP, that is an MP, but that's an AP. And a lot of people, the nuances of that, a lot of people wouldn't care, except he did. That sheet metal pistol, or that's an AP. Who would know that? Bob Bretherton knew it. And he was, fortunately, at the time, he was able to acquire this stuff when it was available. You stated earlier on in the introduction to this collection, this is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. End of story, it's the finest collection of automatic pistols and other arms of, like you said, the wheellocks of its type that's ever come to auction. And I guess we could begin.
Yeah, let's just jump right in.
Yeah, instead of worrying about chronology, although many of the items on this side of the table are the early 20th century, you have your early forms of pistols that, like a Mannlicher, that's a blow-forward action, that actually, if people can see in the camera, it actually worked in reverse of logic. It actually, when the cartridge would load out of the magazine and the grip, it would come back and strike against the firing pin here and go forward. That's called a blow forward Mannlicher pistol.
Like a jungle jet.
But one thing about Bretherton, he wasn't just happy with people would look for their life to have one example. This is one of many, but we particularly have two here on the table, serial number 14 with a factory presentation case and serial number 15. And I think it's real intriguing that, you know, we start with one of the most unique mechanisms. Another early version that's a very early pistol is 1897. It's a Schwarzlos, and we'll talk about mechanisms.
We're talking about antiques here still.
Yes. And this actually, that's 1897. It's the same kind of rotary bolt that's currently in an M16. And that pistol is, well, 1897. And actually, that was the striker. But a totally different mechanism than this pistol that they're within a few years apart. And if long as we're on the early subject, you would have probably the most famous that's in an early antique sort of variation of pistol is this Mauser cone hammer carbine, serial number 9.
Serial number 9.
And it's of they call it a Mauser broom handle, but they actually had a straight blowback action. And that's how it would work. And everything that we've looked at thus far basically is prior to the 20th century.
So we're talking, then that's serial number 9 and in phenomenal condition.
Yeah, and of the, in these carbines, there was approximately 20 of these cone hammers, and I think it was 18 to be exact. There was only two known that had, here's where Bretherton would excel in the example he would seek. This has a reinforced rib like on a shotgun. Well, you know, he wasn't just happy to have one of the example of one of the first 18. He had to have the most unique. And along the same line with the carbines, they evolved from the cone hammer in these variations to the large ring hammer. And this is serial number 48. Works the same exact way. There's no difference in the mechanism between this weapon and the Mauser cone hammer. And the only difference is this large ring hammer. They evolved into the large ring hammer. But serial number 48, and look at his condition. Everything that he had was rare and of high condition. You will not find this. Now, along the same level, as long as we're in the Mausers, Mauser made other weapons, one of which is an 0608 Mauser semi-automatic pistol, that there's a couple of differences in the fact that it does not have an exposed hammer. And you see all this apparatus, how they change everything. It's a, instead of having a rear breech bolt like on the Mauser broom handle and an exposed hammer, it's an internal mechanism. Plus it has, this is 9mm caliber, which is different from the Mauser carbines, which were the 30 caliber bottleneck Mauser cartridge. They were always trying to develop the cartridge, you know, with the 9mm. And the big thing in the straight blowback actions is they had to have a way to keep the slide from basically going in your teeth to make it
ruin everybody's day.
You make it simple. So when you're working with that, they also were thinking about safety, even like with the Mauser broom handles. The hammer's internal, and you had a safety, which was right on the side, that actually, when you're ready to fire, you could, with your thumb, you were ready to fire. I will not snap, it is too valuable of a gun.
Elegant-looking pistol.
Along the same line where the 0608 evolved into, Mauser, going from a 9mm, they really wanted to get to the American market, and the one pistol that they attempted to get that was this 45 caliber. Basically, it's a 1909 model, straight blowback, 45 automatic. But here we go again with Bretherton. He wasn't happy with just having one. There's very few of these. Here is serial number 2.
I love it.
And of the high condition you would expect. What's very similar to this, they evolved into they tried to work with the mechanism a little more, was called a 1214. And basically what's internal with this pistol is there's wings. And the wings actually kept the slide from coming back into your head, which is probably a good thing.
Mm-hmm.
And this pistol brings back a lot of memories. And the fact that I sold this to Bretherton 30 years ago, and it was kind of an interesting thing. I had advertised in Gunlist to buy guns, and I had a contact from an individual who sent me some photos of this from down in the Louisiana area. And so he sent me enough photos, we agreed on a price, and he said, you know, bring cash. And back in those days, you know, I flew to this airport in New Orleans, Louisiana, and right after I got off the plane, I was met with two U.S. Customs officers.
I thought you were going to say girls and bees.
You know, it would have been nicer, so you figure my heart's sinking a little bit. I'm not doing anything illegal. I've got cash, and I wonder who this is, and they asked me my name, and I said who I was, and they said, well, we've been expecting you. And I said, well, okay. The individual that owned this was the head of customs for New Orleans, Louisiana.
Very cool.
So I met in his office. We were very happy with the transaction. There is the case. It's the finest case presentation, 1214 Mauser in existence.
That's a great story. Great gun, great story.
I showed it to Bob, and he did not let it out of his hands, and he became the next owner. But that's one thing about Bob Bretherton, is if you showed him the right thing, he would buy it. And that definitely fell into that. So I don't know if that story bored you, but
No. True. I always love to hear where guns come from. It's a great story.
Along the same line, since we're in the Mauser phase and sticking with the unique pistols, what came after that was this was called a nickel, Mauser nickel patent, which that's what the little N is there. You look at this, and a lot of people we have very astute collectors, and they'll look on here and they'll say, that's a Czech CZ-22 pistol. Well, it's a Czech CZ-22 pistol on steroids because it's bigger and it's 9mm caliber. And that was a very nice specimen. Again, what you would expect from a Bob Bretherton.
Serial number 26.
26, there's very few of them. I've only seen several. I think we cleaned out most of the Mausers, with the exception of on this table, the most common Mauser is probably the most beautiful Mauser.
That's the truth. That's a good way to put it.
It's a factory engraved, not a custom. This is factory engraved presentation. Bolo, which is a shorter, if you'll notice, it's dimensionally smaller than even like the carbines, if they were just a pistol, since we have no common Mausers on the table. There's no reason to show garden variety pistols here. So we're keeping up with that tradition. There is elegance. There is the best of the best. It's near new. It's pictured in a few books. Prior to filming, I was looking up to see. I think it's in Erickson's broom handle book also. So of the most popular field, we pretty much covered Mausers. We covered Mannlichers. Now there's a lot of stuff intermingled here. We did a Schwarzlose. This is another pistol along the same line, trying to get into the American trade with a 45 caliber. They did the 45 caliber tests in 1907, which involved the Luger. This was one of the pistols, not that this specific pistol, but one like it,
right,
was in the test. It's a Danish shoebow in 45 caliber automatic. Again, look at the condition. The one that would have been in the test probably wouldn't have been good enough for Bob because it would have been
right,
all rusty and would have been an assault test. So he just had to have the best one. And keeping up with the tradition of all these different rare automatics, another unique pistol is this Simpson prototype 9mm pistol, which Simpson, as you know, made Lugers between World War I and World War II, and they worked through World War II rebuilding Lugers. But in about 1927, 8, 9, somewhere in there, they made their own prototype pistol for the German military to look at. And you'll notice it has a magazine, basically it's a Luger magazine, but rather than use the button latch that's on, they had a bottom mag release. But here we go again, condition and rarity.
Oh, that's a beautiful gun.
He would stick with all the unique pistols. You had a Webley. That's an early 450 caliber Webley or 455 caliber automatic Webley automatic. Again, condition.
Again, nothing here common. And we just, the purpose is strictly to show the depth of this.
A unique Webley Fosbury. That's a combination semi-automatic slash revolver. you know, worked in a zigzag, like a Mauser did a zigzag type pattern on their manually cocked revolvers. Again, condition. Jumping into totally halfway around the world, here would be a common, but not good enough for Bob Bretherton. He would have to have a grandpa Nambu. Is, you know, the Japanese Nambus, they had a baby, papa, and grandpa, the grandpa being the rarest. This particular one, again, condition, you know, they're a blowback 8mm semi-automatic pistol with a tandem sight. They were fitted for stock. This example does not have a stock, but it definitely is of condition. And here's a very unique pistol. It's a prototype Japanese semi-automatic that had 16 shots.
That's cool. That is neat.
Same caliber as the Papa Nambu. Straight blowback action. Double staggered row magazine. There can't be, again, you know, serial number 3. You know, there can't be, you know, a dozen of them ever made, and he has the best one pictured in the books. And the most common gun on the table, well, okay, we had to have one Luger, but not good enough for Bob. He had to have a prototype Danzig test Luger. You know, doesn't even say DWM on the toggle. It was made for submitting to military tests. 30 caliber, again.
Beautiful.
Condition.
Beautiful.
Now what we'll do is we'll go to switch sides. And we're basically now in the very pre-World War II era when the Nazis were taking power in Germany. And basically right in this section, I'll rather than jump right into the Walthers, I'll show some of the other competitors. This is a Sauer. There's the most common one we have our astute collectors that are on air here. They'll look at that and they'll say, that's a 38H Sauer. No, it's not. It's a Model 36 Sauer. It's a little shorter grip. And this particular one is serial number 210,008. So they would have started it, the way the Germans, the HSCs would have started at 260,000. This is the 8th pistol made in that series. Well, in our research, we looked, and of course this is pictured in the factory display piece is serial number 7. So,
right.
But again, Bretherton quality, unsurpassed, it's of condition. Okay, this, on first glance, very common. You've auctioned hundreds of them. It's a Mauser HSC, but wrong on this one being common. It's one of the first variations where it's called a low grip screw, where usually the grip screw is right here. This particular weapon, the screw is the first ones, the grip screws were low. And rather than have a conventional serial number, the serial number on this is V, just meant prototype. That is the prototype of all the HSC Mausers. Again, Bretherton, that's what he demanded. He demanded to have, in his examples, the best. BSW gas pistol, another attempt to make a 9mm pistol. This came in late in the 1930s, probably approximately 1939. Already, we'll jump to the Walthers here momentarily, because the Walthers are like the Mausers. They're an exercise, and every variation, minutia, in prototype weapons, Walther did it, but they had competitors, one of which being a BSW. Again, look at the condition. Now, what's probably most common on the table, when you look at it, those three weapons are, again, as I stated earlier, the same model. They're MPs, but they look very similar to an AP. We have, not only do we have the most, this would be common in an AP, we've had a few go through the auction in 25 years of these.
And I have to reiterate something. Yeah. When a collection, to speak very frankly, when you make something incredibly rare look common, you know it's special. And that's what we're doing here.
Yeah, I mean, here would be the dream of most people, our viewers have dreamed to own this pistol. It looks, it pales and it looks common here. Please don't think that this is going to be a continual occurrence.
No.
This is a once-in-a-lifetime shot. Here is a AP pistol. And, oh, by the way, while we're at it, how about the same model in a shoulder-stocked version. Long, notice the differences of the long barrel and then this most unique Mauser-style stocked weapon that the gun would go, you know, conceal in the stock. It's all removable. It's the same model. They made, this is 09, they made approximately 10 of them.
Serial number 9, serial number 44.
Right. They made less than 50 total in all of the APs. 10 of them stocked and 40 of the conventionals in both steel frame and alloy. Now, what looks very similar to these, even though it's a different model, this is an MP. It was in the MP was the military test. They made a series of different, they're all different looking. And the difference in this particular one is that they were reinforcing the slide from the AP. It's even fatter. They were making it more durable. They were having difficulties with the frames cracking and slides, so they were attempting to make a more reinforced weapon in and about the same time as the development of the AP. And the pistol next to it, while they're experimenting, they had a lot of time on their hands. Is a sheet metal. This is the only game in town like this. I mean, it's pictured in the books. It's the Holy Grail. And they were just trying a different way of making mass production for the military. But it's the same model basically as that, but look at it.
Right.
It's a shortcut, but extremely rare. And since we're on that same subject, I'll come back to the pistols. In the same subject level, in the development of the rifles, Walther made this GA-115, which, here we go again with Bretherton, serial number 3, you know, and it's marked with a Walther banner. And they were starting to, the basic rifle for the German army, all militaries, was a bolt-action 98 Mauser, so they were attempting to make semi-automatic rifles.
We had, segue here for a second, when we were... We had the pleasure of viewing the collection, where it had resided for many years, and we were going through and kind of inventorying the collection. There was one safe, it had all the semi-automatic rifles. We were pulling them out, and it was like Christmas. And when we saw that gun, I had a similar reaction to the 1894 I've talked about in another video. All you can do is laugh. It is so cool. It is so rare. It is so significant that it's just kind of a pleasure to spend time with it. It is a very, very neat piece.
What this rifle eventually evolved into was a G41. But here we go with Bretherton again with that same thing. If he's going to have one, why not have the first? How about serial number 1001, G41? It's the finest example of a G41 in existence. End of story.
And it's number one.
And it's number one. So we will finish up with the Walthers before we go into to his other varieties of rifles along the same line as an MP. When you say to even the most astute guys, which we have very many of them that are watching this video, when they say an MP, 9 times out of 10, that's what somebody will tell me is an MP. It looks like a PP Walther, which is small 32 on steroids. And that's the most common of a PP, MP. This is serial number 5009, if there is such a thing as common.
Right.
But there isn't. This is, again, condition.
Magnificent.
Magnificent. They started, you know, the 5001 range on up. This is 5009. And then along the same level on another MP, it looks totally different, but looks very similar to a P-38. Here is an MP, serial number 015. They had their
prototype fascinating
ranges.
That's totally fascinating. One looks like a PP, the other one looks like a P-38.
Right. You know, and so guess where they were? You know, they were working all over the board with prototypes.
Everything we're talking about, each one of these pieces would set off even the most advanced collection. They are essentially, they are trophy-worthy pieces. They are trophy guns. There are, you won't find better, you won't find another. But, you know, while we are on the subject of trophies, I'm going to switch places with you, and we're going to talk about these two trophies of war, spoils of war, if you will.
Well, going along that same line, what better example of a trophy or a spoil of war than this presentation Walther PP model that's deep relief engraved. It's of the highest quality. Look at how much metal they removed when they were chiseling, the relief cut. Definitely made for a high-ranking Nazi, because that's the only people that would have been qualified that would have been allowed to have carried the Nazi eagle on the grip. What better example than this for a Walther than this Walther PP? Given that we have to be equal, you remember how we started with the Mausers? We talked about the Walthers. Oh, by the way, how about a Mauser made Luger pistol? Since, you know, we discussed we only had one Luger, because Lugers we consider common. Mm-hmm. Except here we are with a presentation Mauser engraved, same type of quality level of engraving, little not as deep, but very fine, you know, like a shotgun almost. And this particular example has a presentation of the grip to Von Papen that was definitely a soldier that had no longer any use for it. But, you know, and along the same line as the Walther, along that Germanic relief chiseling, they incorporated in the grips.
It's beautiful.
You know, with the wood grips, and they incorporated those oak leaves. But, you know, the same deal. Look at the quality. Look at this weapon. It's the high end in trophies. I'm just taken back. You know, it takes a great deal, as you know. I've been around everything to excite me, and this brings it back to me. This collection is spectacular. You just cannot imagine what it took to put this together, and the only chance that anybody's ever going to have is going to be in these auctions as we sell this collection.
Right. It kind of represents one of the last of the really great old-time collections. Mm-hmm. And the stories and the names that are all associated with it. Everybody was after this collection. Everybody wanted this collection. And, you know, we're proud to have it. We're honored to have it. Again, we have a heightened sense of responsibility in marketing this collection properly and doing each and every piece the justice that it deserves to achieve the most money and to really do the collector, Mr. Bretherton, justice.
So that clears out the pistols and the German rifles, and true to form with Bretherton, and I say this as a show of respect and, you know, my friend, the fact that what he amassed, he wasn't just comfortable with just having German automatics and all the different rifles and pistols. He went evolutionary with other sort. Now, if I'm going to show you a Thompson, what's the first thing
All
of our astute collectors think of? They think of a Thompson submachine gun. Well, how about a Thompson 1923 semi-automatic 30-06 rifle?
You know,
Works like a bolt action semi-automatic. All right, top that. And while he was at it, he wasn't just comfortable having, you know, the evolution of all the semi-automatics after World War I. There was a big rush to develop a semi-automatic rifle for the United States. Okay, how about a 276 1931 Springfield Army Grand prototype, Sumer 15? Well, it isn't like you can go find 14 others. You know, but there, doesn't that look familiar? But this is 1931, not 1944. Right, it was already in play. Along the same line, how about Pedersen was competing with Guerin and working at Springfield Armory at the time, and how about a GX Pedersen, but true to form with Bretherton, how about serial number one?
Serial number one.
We have like a higher serial number we sold in a previous auction, not of this condition that somebody bought and was very successful in getting, was pleased to get it.
It's unbelievable.
But here, we've got serial number one. And in that same time bracket, just like when I spoke to you about the Japanese semi-automatic pistols, the Japanese were developing when Pedersen lost out with the Pedersen rifles a lot of people think of are toggle action. And there's a Pedersen semi-automatic made for Springfield Armory. Then he went to England and made about 500 Pedersen rifles, which we've had. Mm-hmm. Well, at the same time, his development ended up going to Japan with a toggle action Pedersen style, but for Japan in the early 1930s, probably 1929, could have been. But true to form with Bretherton. How about serial number one? And that's kind of like it. You dug it, you know, out of a pile. It's very beautiful in condition. And probably the most prolific, that the dream gun of most collectors, is the Japanese made a copy of an M1. Their attempt to make a copy of an M1.
They say imitation is the greatest form of flattery.
And here we go. It's now, would you want to shoot it? I don't think so. But we haven't had one of these in 20 years probably in the auction. And then true to form with Bretherton, why not have a really good one? Now, these were crude because they're late in the war. They were getting bombed into submission by B-29s. And they were still able to make that. And there's very few of them.
It's unbelievable. And I hope this video properly illustrates the depth, the significance of the Robert Bretherton collection. I mean, just to recap, we have two serial number one, very important, very significant semi-automatic rifles sitting side by side. Again, there's nothing on this table that is common. There is nothing in this, well, I should say there's hardly anything in this collection that is common, that's not extraordinary, that's not in phenomenal condition. And it's not just the Bretherton collection. Our April 29th, 30th, and May 1st sale is like nothing we've seen in the firearms auction business for quite some time. The amount of significant pieces across all genres, starting in the 17th century and moving forward to the most advanced Class 3 weapons of the day. Today we have in force, in quantity, in quality, in rarity, in prototypes. It's here. It's for sale. So if you have any interest, if you are a gun enthusiast, an amateur historian, a gun collector, I can't encourage you enough to come to our preview day, which is April 28th. See this stuff in person, put it in your hands, because the only other shot you're going to get is with your face pressed up against museum glass. I can guarantee you that, especially when you're talking about this much depth, this much condition, this much rarity. It really is, and we truly have a heightened sense of responsibility when it comes to marketing this stuff, when it comes to properly educating our customers about what this stuff is, because I got to be honest with you, there's not many people that can go through this. Actually, there's no one that I know of that can go through this like Richard can. What he did was just now was fabulous. He went gun by gun and like an encyclopedia, just like Mr. Bretherton. So it's an honor to have this bestowed upon us to market and auction this collection. We hope you enjoy it just as much as we do. I know collectors will be talking about it for decades to come. It is a very significant moment in firearms collecting. So we hope to see you in April. We hope you enjoy it. Thank you.